Well, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
Welcome, everyone, to Victory this morning. All right, our announcements this morning. Melavita Karenette Counseling Classes, Monday, tomorrow, 4:30 to 7:30 p.m. Questions about that, see Brandy. Wednesday Adult Bible Study, Wednesday Kids Classes, Wednesday Teen Classes, Thursday Lambs, good morning, Fred. Thursday Melavita Karenette Counseling. Friday Aspire Teen Night. Just read your bulletin, it's all important, it's all on there. So I can't think of anything else that really needs to be said this morning. Does anybody else have any announcements that need to be made? All righty, good. Prayers, Missy Mitchell sitting over here with her waving hand. She has prayers this morning, if you have a request, get it filled out. If you noticed in your bulletin, there's a pamphlet, book, whatever you want to call it. It's Voice of Martyrs. It's kind of talking about God's word in various places in the world and what's been going on there, how they're being received, how everything is going with them. Read it. It's pretty good reading. Okay, I said any other announcements? Nobody had one, so we'll go on. Stand with me for a call to worship, please. John 4:23. New Living Translation says, "But the time is coming. Indeed, it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship Him that way." Amen. Father God, we are children. Lord, we are so hopeful that when we do worship You, it's in truth and in spirit, Lord. Father, I just pray that, Lord, as we speak to You, that everything we say just comes across in the right way, Lord. Help us to just be how You want us to be. Guide us, direct us. Father, today as we come into Your presence through music this morning, Lord, Lord, I just pray for a special anointing upon our music group this morning. Lord, I just pray that you just minister to them and let them minister to You, back to You, Lord. Father, we know that our praises and our singing, our songs are pleasing to You, Lord. Father, we pray that You just help us when we go into a study of the Word this morning. I just pray that, Lord, that Your Word just burns itself into our being. Just helps us to just, Lord, it helps us to just draw closer to You. Now, Lord, as we prepare our hearts and minds to enter into this phase of our worship, I just pray that you just guide and direct our thoughts. Help us to keep our thoughts focused on You, Lord. Guide and direct us in the name of Jesus. What? Oh, yeah. You know, we're real close to just greeting everybody.
Yeah.
I almost want to say it, but just wait another week or so and just smile and wave at somebody close to you.
Hey, Brad.
Oh, Lee.
Good
morning. Can you lead worship this
That's too late.
Congratulations.
Who come in?
Mr. Howard. Mr. Howard, Mr. Fine, Dr. Howard.
Good morning.
Good morning. Well, I bet about two people thought that. They're so used to hearing me talking.
Yeah, Mr. Friday, you didn't show up.
You know what?
Oh,
great to be back, you guys. Well, thank you for your prayers. So amazing. We have a, don't we serve a wonderful God?
Yes.
We're going to get through this together, everybody. He's in charge, and we're going to get this thing done. All right, let's go to prayer. Let's go to the Lord. Heavenly Father, this is the time in the service when we lift our voices to you, Father, and I pray that you're satisfied and you're pleased with what you're hearing, Father. And we want to get our hearts and our minds set, Father, and to be receptive of Jim's sermon today and anyone who's speaking today, Father. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
We sang it like we believed it, amen?
Amen.
Especially after Resurrection Sunday. My goodness.
Ephesians 7:10. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to the purpose which he has set forth in Christ, as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, and things of heaven and things of earth. With that, let's praise him.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
This question, can you remember when you first came to the Lord?
Oh, yeah.
Remember that, maybe that first day, that first week, that first month, that first year. And if you think back, whether it's even 6 months ago or 40 years ago, that person that you knew as you is gone. Amen?
Amen.
Gone.
Thank you, Jesus.
Dead. Alive in Christ. The dead to self.
Sunday, we know that you've won, Lord. We know that we've won. We know that together in your name, Father, we are going to live a mighty and amazing life in eternity with you, Lord. And that's already happened. It's already been done. There's nothing that can take that away from us, Father. And I ask you today as we come together in prayer to lift each heart to you, Lord, to renew every spirit, knowing that you are the way, the truth, and the light. Lord, we forget how quickly we forget every day, every minute. We come into these trials in this world, Lord. Maybe it's our family. Maybe it's our health. Maybe it's opportunities we think that we've lost or things that we've given up. Lord, maybe it's just how the world has worked around us in that day. Maybe people are cruel and unkind, Lord, and maybe we are suffering in this moment. Lord, put it in our hearts that we are not to dwell in that. We are not to think about these things that come before us, Lord, but we are to set our face on you. And in every moment that we come here together, Lord, we have that opportunity to be reminded that all these things in this world are meaningless. The things that we are putting before you, Lord, the things that we put first every day, the things that don't matter at all, Father, we know that those things are not important. But it's hard. It's hard when we're in this world to not follow this world, to not try to fit in, to not try to just get in line and do what we're told. And Lord, we know that the only person that should be telling us what to do is you. Lord, I ask for a renewed fire today in each heart that has come to face you in this moment, in this room, in this morning. Lord, just light us up for you and for the word, and send us back out into the world today renewed in the spirit of how great you are. Don't let us dwell in these things. Father, bring your Holy Spirit today to tear down the walls and the defenses we have put up against things that we shouldn't be defending from. Father, bring your Spirit and ask us to come with you today. Yes. If you don't know this, if you're in this room today and you've been a Christian for so long that maybe it's dull, or maybe today is your first day trying to find Jesus' face, Father, we ask that you be with that person and just renew us. And help us to know that no matter what happens here, we are already safe with you.
Yes, amen. Yes.
So, Father, we ask for additional prayers for those people who have not mentioned it, for those people who do not have it written out here today or in the bulletin or in the book. Lord, we know that there are people suffering. We know they're suffering here in this church, in this community, in this state, in this country, and all over the world. Father, we lift up those people who have acted in your name and are being persecuted today. And we just ask that they be glorified in your spirit, Lord. And just let everything that you do shine through them and show all of us why it means so much. Father, today we ask for special prayer for Cheyenne Haney. She gave birth 2.5 weeks early to the Pradke's great-granddaughter, Isabella May. She's already feeling overwhelmed. Please pray for her and her beautiful, healthy baby. Father, you ask us to bring life forth into this world and to spread the good news and to continue to populate the world, Lord. And we just ask for your protection over all those people who are going through the births of babies and trying to understand what they need to do with these babies and how to raise them up to be important in your kingdom. Father, we ask for this blessing over that family and all the people who are working on their families in this moment, Lord, that they be safe and brought back to you. And we ask all this in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Once again, I mean, after that prayer, what else? I mean, good morning.
Good morning.
Much better. Okay. It's really neat. Last week, Sunday school was real good about this. When you're looking in the scriptures and you get enlightened, you see something that you didn't see before, or you have a greater understanding or a different understanding than what you knew before. That kind of hit me with this verse. I read a proverb a day. It's kind of easy to do. There's 31. What day of the month is it? There's your proverb. And in Proverbs 18, verse 16, a gift opens the way and ushers the giver into the presence of the great. Well, with this, who is the great? God knows the power of the gift. It's God. And because it's a gift, that's why he didn't institute a church tax. And he wanted every gift to be given from one's own will, so that when the blessings come, we understand how God worked through our gift to prosper our well-being. We have now a moment of opportunity to be ushered into the presence of God by giving to him as he so graciously has given to us. Let us pray.
Heavenly Father, thank you for giving us the opportunity to give a portion back to you after all the wonderful gifts that you've given us, especially in the form of your Son, Jesus Christ. For it's in his name I pray. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, some of you might have noticed we weren't here last week. Did any of you have a relaxing week last week?
Not like yours.
Huh. Yeah, we just got back last night from vacation. Do any of you guys feel like sometimes a vacation is just exhausting?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah?
Yours wasn't.
Well, you don't even get a chance to relax, Jay. That's really the problem. There's so much concern about what you're going to do next. If you're going to be there on time, if you had made reservations. Hoping that everyone has a good time. There isn't time just to let anything happen. One of the most enjoyable days I had last week was Easter Sunday. I told Miss that I wanted to go to church. And I said that it was a priority for me. So, as it happens, if you've ever mentioned something, if you have an idea and you mention it to your wife, then you get to make it happen. So she said she wanted me to pick what it was, or where we went. So, before I started looking, I prayed that God would lead us to somewhere that his word was taught. And I didn't want to be entertained. I wanted to be fed. And this crazy thing happened. It happened. It's not too much of a surprise because God said, if you look, you'll find him. So when it comes to our lives, we get distracted a lot by what we think we should be doing. We get busy doing things that are familiar, things we think might help us relax, something to take our minds off whatever it is that's stressing us out today. The disciples, just as after crucifixion, did the same thing. In John chapter 20, it said that Jesus had appeared to Mary, his disciples, and Thomas. And then chapter 21 starts with a story that I'm sure some of you might know. It tells about another encounter between Jesus and his disciples. Chapter 21 says, afterward, Jesus appeared again to his disciples by the Sea of Tiberias. It happened this way. Simon Peter, Thomas, Nathanael from Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two other disciples were together. I'm going out to fish, Simon Peter told them. And they said, we'll go with you. So they went out and got into the boat. But that night they caught nothing. Early in the morning, Jesus stood on the shore, but the disciples did not realize it was Jesus. He called out to them, friends, haven't you any fish? No, they answered. He said, throw your net on the right side of the boat, and you'll find some. When they did, they were unable to haul the net in because of the large number of fish. Then the disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, it is the Lord. As soon as Simon Peter heard him say it, he wrapped his outer garment around him and jumped into the water. The other disciples followed in the boat, towing the net full of fish, for they were not far from the shore, about 100 yards. When they landed, they saw a fire burning coals with fish on it, and some bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish you just caught." Simon Peter climbed aboard and dragged the net above ashore. It was full of large fish, 153. But even with so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." None of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came, took the bread and gave it to them, and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time Jesus appeared to his disciples after he was raised from the dead. If you're anything like me, when you read this story, you notice the big picture. We get hung up on the fact that they caught a lot of fish. They caught them because Jesus directed them, but they caught a lot of fish. Apparently, they were just fishing off the wrong side of the boat only. But verse 9 has some detail that I've somehow passed right over without giving it a second thought. When they landed, they saw a fire of burning coals, and there were fish on it and some bread. Jesus had already made breakfast. He had prepared a place for them. And then in verse 13, he served it to them. As we go through life, perhaps struggling, our Father sees us. This story tells us that we may put ourselves into some situations that don't play out like we hope. But we worship an awesome God.
Yes.
A God who loves us so much that you may, that He may direct the fish into our net and sometimes just get us to the shore. Amen. The best part is that in the end, He has already prepared a place for us. He went to the cross to redeem us. He went to the grave to free us. And that tomb is still empty because He's still working. He prepared His table. Let's thank Him.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, I thank You that You have given us the opportunity to gather together today to worship You, Lord, to give You thanks, Lord, for providing this life for us, providing us a way that we could spend an eternity with You. Lord, we face some struggles, some struggles we create on our own, and some that are just laying in wait for us to stumble into. Lord, but You are there. Lord, You are there to see us through anything we fall into or come to, Lord. And if You bring us to something that seems hard, Lord, You will bring us through it, because that's what You do. You are a God of conquering. Lord, there's nothing in this world that You haven't overcome, even death. Lord, we thank You for Your Son, and thank You for loving us enough that You would sacrifice Him so that we could be with You where You are. In His name we pray. Amen.
I would like to make a personal invitation to you. Today, after for Sunday school, after the worship today, we are going to be looking at the gates of hell. And we have, I think, the proper definition, explanation of that term and what Jesus was saying and all the implications and just powerful stuff. We watched about 20 minutes of DVD. Who likes to watch TV? Just raise your hands. Yeah. And so we watched about 20 minutes of TV. We had some great discussion. And we look at the scriptures, and it's going to come alive. It's going to make so much sense. So I want to invite you right after the worship today. And most likely, you picked up a Voice of the Martyrs, the oversized insert, right? And I would like for all of us, if you would just turn with me to page 14, towards the back. I want to read a small little section, just like three paragraphs. I don't know about you, but for me, it helps me to get a perspective on being a Christian and what some Christians experience because of their faith and the power of God to work through things that are difficult. And at least for me, it gives me a better perspective. Page 14, saved from human sacrifice through Christ's sacrifice. Pastor Momadu grew up in Kena Tortor, which was known as a headquarters for witchcraft. Among the other gods, villagers worshipped the python, the gods in the trees, and the human god, who lived in a hut surrounded by demons. Every year, the god required 6 human sacrifices. When Momadu was a teenager, he was selected to be a human sacrifice. Although his father was one of the witchcraft leaders, he did not want to lose his son, so they fled to another village. It was there that Mamadou heard the gospel and became a Christian. When they returned home about a year later, Mamadou began telling others about Jesus. Villagers were interested because they were afraid of the gods they had been serving and no longer wanted to sacrifice their children. They soon decided to give up witchcraft and follow Jesus, and they appointed Mamadou as their preacher. Every Sunday, he shares what he has learned from listening to the audio Bible. And all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. And there's so many stories like this. We invite you to please to just peruse, to investigate, whatever term you'd like to use. Go through that material. It's just fantastic. Well, today's title is this. It's a double click. I forgot. A Real Body, Flesh and Bones. This is, I think, an important topic because maybe we just don't get it, or we've never learned it. Maybe we've forgotten it. But what we're going to do is we're going to stay on the theme and kind of in that timeline of Resurrection Sunday. We're still going to stay here. It's just like it's Resurrection Sunday again. The whole day was so exciting. And early aspects of a risen Savior really confused the disciples. Initially, there were some unanswered questions. In Luke chapter 24, on the same day as the resurrection, Jesus met and walked and dined with 2 believers on the road to Emmaus. Have you ever heard that in the scriptures, the road to Emmaus? Okay. Nobody. There we go. All right. Good. It's good to see some hands. Okay. After these 2 believers, and we know one's name was Cleopas, but when they had met the risen Lord on the road to Emmaus, they came to Jerusalem that evening, and they met with other disciples in a home. And we're going to kind of pick up on this road to Emmaus, although our message is really focusing on the next thing that happened in the evening. So Cleopas and the other Christian companion experienced the risen Lord, and we pick up in Luke 2:33. And they, the two, rose that same hour and returned to Jerusalem. And they found the 11 disciples and also those who were with them gathered together, saying, the Lord has risen indeed. You know, when we have that, especially on Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday, we say, He is risen.
He is risen
indeed. And we get that right from scriptures. And so the two from Emmaus, these two, they come, they start sharing, they start talking, and all of a sudden they hear from the 11 and from the other disciples that were in that room, they have heard about what happened to Peter. They say, the group says to those two from Emmaus, the Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon, whose name is also Cephas. Cephas, we're going to see that in a moment. So when Cleopas and the companion came, they start going back and forth, sharing these their stories. But their story, those two, their story was validated because Jesus had appeared to Peter also. We read in Luke 24, verse 35, then they told what had happened on the road. So now they're sharing their story with the group. Then they told what had happened on the road and how he was known to them in the breaking of the bread. Now, interestingly, and a little later on in church history, when Paul wrote to the Corinthian church, his first letter, he wrote, for I delivered to you as of first importance. It sounds like it's really important. As a parent, you leave your home, and you got kids are staying home, let's say. Okay, they're old enough to stay home. You figure at 24, they're good enough, right? Okay, so they stay home, and you tell them the really important things when you leave, right?
Right.
Like, don't do this, right? Don't do this. And so this is the important thing. Paul writes, for I delivered to you as first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, important, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, that's Peter, then to the 12. So we have all these scriptures really agreeing with one another. But think of this room where Christians are gathered together. We have two different experiences as they're sharing together. One group and Peter, they're telling the two, and the two are going to tell their story now in verse 35, because we read, and they, the two, they told what happened on the road and how he, Jesus, was known to them in the breaking of the bread when they were at the table in Emmaus. So they're trying to share these exciting notes, recalling their experience, and really still trying to make sense of all of it. It is such an awesome event, this resurrection. And we read next, I love this, and as they were talking about these things, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, peace to you. A sudden appearance. How's that for a shock? I mean, think about it. How many of us have had our kids scare us? Why? Because they like to, right? They like to do. I like to stare at my kids sometimes, or my grandkids. I just like to sing to them like that for a second, just for 1 second. But think about this, you know, and how often have we been frightened because all of a sudden we didn't know that our spouse or one of the kids was there, we turned and boom, freaked out. We're in a, not panic, but we're startled, right? So as they're talking about these, I mean, they're talking about Jesus, and all of a sudden, boom, Jesus is there. And he said to them, peace to you. And we read in John's Gospel, chapter 20, he writes that the doors were shut. So he just appeared. And so now in Luke, as we're reading, Luke takes these two separate stories of the two on the road to Emmaus and the group of Peter who has seen the risen Lord, and that he's combining them, bringing them together, because now Jesus appears to all of them, at least to that large group. And this appearance now is Easter, or less better yet, Resurrection Sunday in the evening. So a lot has happened in one day. The resurrection, Jesus meets the two disciples, believers on the road to Emmaus. And now as those two from Emmaus come to Jerusalem in the evening and fellowship and share their stories, Jesus appears that evening to all of them. And we read, of course, they were startled and frightened and thought they saw a spirit. I mean, Jesus said, peace to you, but, you know, it's like, peace to you. Boom. They're frightened. They're in a panic. Jesus appears, and it's the very likeness of the Jesus they know that just died a couple days ago. He looks like Jesus who was buried. And they thought it was a ghostly, supernatural phantom, an aberration. Because no human can suddenly appear and materialize, right? Out of thin air. In a locked room. And Jesus said to them, why are you troubled and why do doubts arise in your hearts? And I think it's about the reality of the resurrection. And I think what Jesus says is so significant for us today as we try to understand the resurrection. Because sometimes I was talking with a brother, we can get a little confused about the reality, the physical reality of the resurrection. So this is so important, so essential to our understanding of the resurrection, Jesus's and ours. Luke 24, verse 39, Jesus says, see my hands and my feet, that it is I myself. I love this. Remember this. Touch me and see me. Touch me and see me. We're going to go back to this later. For a spirit does not have what? Flesh and bones as you see that I have. What? The resurrected Jesus Christ, his glorious body, this resurrected body, this transformation, he has flesh and bones. And he invites, actually commands the disciples to see and to touch him. See my hands and feet and touch. And when the Apostle John, who was there that night, wrote in a letter, one of his letters, his first letter to the church. And again, remember, we're just reading, see my hands and my feet, that it is I, touch me and see. In 1 John, when he would write a letter to the church later, he wrote, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and this is with the intention to investigate something, like maybe his hands and his feet, right? Which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands. There is no doubt they are referring to Resurrection Sunday that evening in that room when Jesus appeared. That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with a view to investigate, which we have looked upon and have touched with our hands concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest. It is the same word in the original language as the word appear. Important. The life was made manifest. The life appeared. And we have seen it and testified to it and proclaimed to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us, or who appeared to us. That very evening on Resurrection Sunday. Let's go back to verse 39 again. It's so important. Jesus said, see my hands, my feet, that it is I myself. Touch me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones as you see that I have. Jesus, with his new transformed, glorious body, still retains the identifying marks from his death on the cross. again, this is so important. I'm so excited about this message. It helps me too. I think as Christians, we get a little confused about the idea of there being something that is just kind of spiritual, it's kind of ethereal, but it's not physical. Bottom line, when we become Christians, when we die, the body is just kind of decomposes, but our souls, that word is, it is who we really are. It's like when you get into a car, the car is moving because you're in it, right? You're driving it. Well, you know, this body is just, it's like when God made this body, he made Adam, it was just there until he breathed life. And man became a living soul, right? So when we pass away, now when we die, that body goes. I don't know how to spell that, but it happens. And our souls go to be with the Lord. Our very lives, who we truly are, our real lives, they go, immaterial, I guess, we go to be with the Lord. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Okay. So, but then one day, and I believe this is at the rapture. One day our souls will reunite, but it won't be with that old decaying body that we had. There will be a new, transformed, glorious body, not some ethereal, ghost-like aberration, a real body.
Amen.
Thank God.
Wow. Because I really believe from the very beginning until the time when the Lord returns, we were meant to have a body. But a new, some kind of new, glorious, supernatural, yet with flesh and bones, fit for heavenly life. There will be a real resurrection, just like when Jesus was resurrected. A physical reality. And we look at Luke 24:40. And when Jesus had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. And while they still disbelieve for joy and were marveling, and it almost sounds like they don't believe, right? Almost sounds like, oh no, somebody could say if there's a skeptic, well, see, they didn't believe it. Well, have you ever had something wonderful happen to you? It was just so exciting. You never expected it. You're just like shocked. And you say, I can't believe it, right? But really, you do believe it because it just happened, right? And that's what's happening here. If you look at the phrase, and while they still disbelieve for joy, see, for joy, Jesus says to them, and I love this, have you anything to eat? My first thought was, got milk? That's what I'm thinking. What? And so they're having this joy. Jesus is hungry, I guess. And I think what's interesting, too, before he died, Jesus said, he told his disciples they will grieve, right? They will grieve. And he was pointing to his death and burial. But then he said, their grief will turn to you joy. And that is what they're experiencing right now. While they still disbelieve for joy and were marveling, and Jesus happens to say to them, have you anything here to eat? And you know, this really shows us that the resurrection of Jesus was not some contrived, concocted story. The disciples were frightened out of their socks. They didn't wear socks. And they were frightened because they were frightened out of their socks. They just wore sandals. Little known fact. It was so unexpected, so fearful, this appearance, this manifestation of the risen Christ. And just to prove the physical reality of Jesus' resurrection and this new transformed resurrection body, to give additional evidence of his physical resurrection, because ghostly or spirits and disembodied spirits don't eat, right? Jesus asked the question, have anything here to eat? And this concept really shouldn't surprise us when we look at God, the Lord, visiting people in the Old Testament. One example, we have two heavenly beings, divine beings, along with God, the Lord. They are in a physicality. They are their flesh and their bones. Two are angels. I believe one is the pre-incarnate Jesus Christ in Genesis chapter 18. So the Lord and these two divine beings are with Abraham. And Abraham prepares a meal for them. And the servants help provide a meal. And we read that he, Abraham, took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it before them. That's the Lord and two divine beings. And he stood by them under the tree while they, what? Ate. The next chapter over, chapter 19, one of those two angels went to rescue Lot, who was residing in the city of Sodom. We read this. The two angels came to Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gate of Sodom. When Lot saw them, he rose to meet them and bowed himself with his face to the earth and said, My lords, please turn aside to your servant's house and spend the night and wash your feet. Then you may rise up early and go on your way. And they said, no, we'll spend the night in the town square. But he, Lot, pressed them strongly. So they turned aside to him and entered his house. And he made them a feast and baked unleavened bread. And they, what? Ate. So, scripturally speaking, this should not be surprising. And yes, there are a lot of differences between heavenly bodies and earthly bodies, but there's also some similarities. Back to Luke 24, verse 41. And while they still disbelieved for joy and were marveling, he said to them, Jesus, have you anything to eat? They gave him a piece of broiled fish. How specific is this, right? How specific? I mean, I know they didn't say it was tilapia. It wasn't Parmesan crusted tilapia. But you know what I'm saying? It's pretty specific. Broiled fish, they gave it to him. He took it and ate it before them. The fact that Jesus ate broiled fish in their presence was proof that he was not a phantom, he was not a ghost, an aberration. It was a physical, supernatural new body made of flesh and bones. This is amazing. And not just for those disciples 2,000 years ago, this is amazing for us today. We too should really be astonished. I mean, when we say he is risen indeed, right? Because what we are now, mortal, is not what we will be one day, immortal. Because Jesus' story is our story. And his victory is our victory. I mean, think about it. Jesus' resurrected body, a body different than his previous body before he was crucified. He could appear. He could disappear. He possessed flesh and bones. Supernatural. But it was flesh and bone. On Resurrection Sunday, the resurrection was not just a resuscitation of a corpse. A dead body. It was a transformation of Jesus into his eternal state with a real body. And if anyone explains this beautifully, it is the Apostle Paul when he wrote in 1 Corinthians 15. But some will ask, how are the dead raised? With what kind of body do they come?
You foolish person. What you sow does not come to life unless it dies. What you sow and throw into the ground, bury, right? Does not come to life unless it dies. And what you sow is not the body that is to be, but a bare kernel, perhaps of wheat or of some other grain. But God gives it a body as he chooses, and to each kind of seed its own body. For not all flesh is the same. There is one kind of flesh for humans, another for animals, another for birds, and another for fish. And I love this next verse. There are heavenly bodies, and we're talking bodies, and their counterpart, there are earthly bodies. But the glory of the heavenly is of one kind, and the glory of the earthly is another. You see, there are proper bodies for heavenly beings, and there are proper bodies right now, where we're still alive here in these bodies, there are proper bodies for earthly beings. But that will change. There are heavenly bodies and earthly bodies. But the glory of the heavenly is of one kind, and the glory of the earthly is of another. Now Paul starts talking about the planets and the stars. There is one glory of the sun and another glory of the moon. Another glory of the stars, for star differ from star in glory. Now think about this. Listen, I'm going to just add in this idea of being buried. So it is with the resurrection of the dead. What is sown, buried, is perishable. Amen? What is raised is imperishable. It is sown, buried in dishonor. It is raised in glory. That's the new supernatural body, right? Flesh and bones. It is sown, if I may, buried in weakness. It is raised in power. It is sown, buried a natural body. It is raised a spiritual body. And he continues, if there is a natural body, there is also a spiritual body.
Amen.
Wow. Talking about a brain teaser, right? And again, remember Jesus told his disciples, touch and see. And we read just a little while ago, and I'm going to reread it, what John wrote in 1 John 1. When he wrote, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon with in view to investigate, and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life. The life was made manifest. The life appeared. And I'm sure he's talking about that evening. Resurrection Sunday evening. The life was made manifest. The life appeared. And we have seen it. And testify to it, and proclaim to you the eternal life which was with the Father and was made manifest to us, appeared to us. And I think especially that evening on Resurrection Day. So, as we close, keeping this thought, let's look at our lot in Jesus Christ. John wrote, 1 John chapter 3, see what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God. And so we are presently, continually. The reason why the world does not know us is because it did not know Him. Beloved, we are God's children now. And what we will be in our supernatural bodies has not yet appeared or manifested. But we know that when He, Jesus, appears, is made manifest, just like He was to His disciples, that resurrection day in the evening, we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him. New, transformed, supernatural bodies. A supernatural body, a real body. Flesh and bones. That all God's people have to say.
Amen.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we thank you for this message today. We thank you for this reminder that you came back. You came back in the flesh. And you are present with us right now, even though we can't see you. And until the day when you come back, Father, as our Savior, you come back in the clouds and everyone sees you. I pray that you help us to keep on track on the path that you need us to be on. I pray that you help us to do the things that we need to do in this world, Father, to prepare others, to hopefully make other disciples, Father, so that people know who you are and they will understand who you are when you come back. And we look forward to the day when we are with you in heaven again. And we just thank you, Father, for this promise. We thank you for the word, and we just thank you for everything that you do for us as we are here on this world, Father. And we give you all the praise, the glory, and the honor. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand. Let's stand and sing it.
Yeah.
Jesus, I believe.
My neighbor, I live on 250 West, just between 10 and 500.
Yeah.
And, but anyway, I was going down the street the other day. I noticed my neighbor's been putting fencing up and all that. You know, went by there. You guys go.
You too.
They are visible.
Yeah, they're pretty visible down here. Three great messages today.
You kind of fell in line pretty good, didn't
you? Yeah. That
answered a question for you, too. I struggled with that passage Jim was on.
Which
in other words, with the resurrected body, you know, we got it, and we're raised again with a body like that. I never made the connection between how can we have a body that rots, and well, now I know.
Yeah.
Come back with him again.
Yeah.
And what a nice analogy.
Did you notice what was missing from that though?
Hmm.
The blood. The blood mentioned, because the blood was shed for a sin.
That's pretty cool, though.
Yeah.
No, appreciate that, you know. I can stay with that.
Now, I might be wrong.
No, I don't think so, because he's never left.